Everybody is still locked up in the past. They all want to go back to what it was, as opposed to saying, you can't go back to what it was. You got to go forward. And that's a tough choice. Because what it was, we know how it is. In the future, we don't know how it is going to be. And that's the challenge I see everywhere. Just to give another idea, I have a couple of minutes. In 1994, I came up with an idea of mobile wallet, to put a wallet on cell phone. I filed some patents in Chicago, started in 96, filed some more in 96, hired McKinsey & Company and set up a business to build mobile wallet. This was in 98. Then internet bubble came, everything sort of went crazy. Yesterday, Verizon, AT&T, and T-Mobile launched their mobile wallet in Austin, Texas, and Salt Lake City. I designed that. It is my technology. But it took 15 years. Pioneers always have arrows in the back. It takes a lot of blood and sweat and tears. And I think that's the kind of vision we need today everywhere. Everything I see is about to change. And that requires young talent. Because it is their future that is at stake. So when I do something in India, I always keep in mind 550 million young below age of 25. They need to build smart cities of tomorrow. They need to push for disaster management systems for every little place. They need to really work on managing traffic, providing security, providing all kinds of new services to citizens. Everywhere you look around, there are unique opportunities for new technology, new solutions, new vision. And I think we are all fortunate to be living in very exciting times. These are the best of the best times that I know of in the human history. World is coming together, it is becoming as one little village. Differences are fewer. I know when I came to Chicago 50 years ago what it meant to walk in the South Side. I went to school at IIT. Things have changed. I think we have a great city. I must say Mayor Daley did a great job in building this city. I have seen this city grow, and it's so beautiful now. I think we are all lucky to have the right technology, right tools, but we need to think differently. We cannot think the way we have been thinking and hope to take advantage of the new tools. And that's the message I have. Thank you.
Like to take some questions from our audience because you've stimulated a great conversation here.
I'd be delighted if you have time. You are the organizer.
We will make it, yes. Thank you.
I will.
Please.
Mm-hmm. It's like talking to my family. I mean, because people are, you know, many faces I know for a long time.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
I'm curious about the statement you made about dedicating the facial recognition and unique ID for every person in India. I think in the U.S., that might raise some concerns in some quarters. What's the objective and how do you deal with civil liberties issues?
The main objective is to really improve delivery of public services, create transparency, accountability. See, we have a lot of leakage in the delivery of public services. A lot of middlemen trying to steal here, steal there, corruption, all that is part of life in emerging societies. Technology can bring about openness, accessibility, connectivity, networking, democratization, decentralization, and hopefully social transformation. If people think that your privacy is a major issue, they are kidding themselves. Everybody knows what you're doing everywhere. I use my credit card, and they know where I am, what I do. Okay. So I think this privacy issue is just overdone. There is not much privacy. And when you travel, they know what you're doing. You can scan all kinds of documents. So we didn't pay too much attention. Of course, there's a little bit of privacy issue. I'm not saying it's all zero. But we felt that unique ID is going to be very important in delivering public services. Food distribution, ration card is a big thing in India. You know, where poor people get delivery of food at lower prices. We have a program in India today called Employment Guarantee Scheme, where 150 million people get minimum 100 days of wages work because they are very poor. How do you pay 110 million every month? How do you make sure that they got paid? You need technology. Without technology, they don't get paid. Somebody else gets paid. Money goes out. And that's what we are trying to do, is improve efficiency, productivity, transparency, and all that. It's a tough battle, a lot of resistance. Yes.
Thank you for a very inspirational message, and really appreciated that. Now, you talked about thinking differently. How do you really inspire people to think differently? How do you teach them? How do you institutionalize that?
I don't have all the answers. But I'm in charge of innovations in India. And when I took that task, I said, look, it is one thing to innovate for a company, it's another thing to innovate for a nation. Two separate things. I'm in the task of building a nation and not building a company. I quit building a company a long time ago because it didn't interest me. And my son and I have this argument all the time. He said, Dad, how come you didn't make billion? And I said, it just somehow didn't interest me. So innovation at a national level is very different from innovation at a corporate level and at a personal level. It has to come from within. I mean, all the books are there. Dozens of books on everything you want to do. How much of that we practice? It's all known knowledge. I mean, I am a firm believer in Gandhian thinking. That's the Indian Gandhi. To me, he's my role model. Simplicity, sacrifice, unconditional love for everybody. These are all simple things. How do you practice it? So everything we need to know is already out there. How do you put it in and practice is a challenge. I don't know the answer, really.
Thank you for such.
Can you hear me?
Oh, there we go.
Thank you for such an inspiring message. With the current issue with a talent crunch around the world, actually. But I was thinking of Citibank, an organization that has half of its employees non-U.S. born, and they're incenting them to come here to the United States to work from around the world in all different areas. So I was just thinking about India in terms of the many Indians that come here to not just be educated, but and they end up staying, and then they end up getting visas and working in the organization. Do you guys, have you thought about a program, or is there a program, or what is your thoughts around incenting the talent that leaves your country to get educated, to come back and help build?
To me, this is global talent. Okay. I don't see problem as Indian and American problem anymore. No, I said I don't see it that way. I see this talent is global. Same talent could be here for a while and maybe after 5 years it will be in Africa. Or the fellow will go to Latin America. Doesn't really matter. Talent is talent. Let them have the choice. Don't restrict them. You know, young people should not be restricted. Let them do whatever they want to do. Some right, some wrong. We did it. Okay, how can I say they should be restricted? Okay. So I think this first question is we definitely need to build more talent everywhere. Because even in US, we need today 100,000 software engineers. There was a Wall Street Journal article just a few days ago. We don't have it. We need 400,000 nurses. We don't have it. Why can't we train 100,000 software engineers Why can't we train 20,000 in Chicago? I think we can. Do we have the political will to do it? I don't know. I mean, there are a lot of bright young kids around here, I know. You know, they can be trained. They don't have to have a PhD in software. But you can train them probably in a year or two to do interesting work. Today, tools are very different. You know, my generation had to learn machine language programming. Pretty complicated. Okay, I learned all of that. Microprogramming and all kinds of crap. It's all useless today. You know, today I just can get some young guy to just, you know, start programming in 6 months. Open source, you know, cloud computing, mobile applications, and you know, get on iPad. They know it already anyway. I give this example. I have a 20-month-old granddaughter. She lives in San Francisco. She Skypes every day. What is this? They don't have a Skype. 20 months. Okay. Immediately she'll push a button and she'll say, hi, Dada. She'll tell me something to do. And I get amazed. Because her idea of grandfather is somebody who lives in virtual space. That's a different world. You know? And I'm not willing to accept some of it. So we got to think from their perspective. And I think we can train 100,000 software engineers. Doesn't have to come from India, doesn't have to come from anywhere, if we want. But if we can't, then they'll come from all over. Okay, which is okay too. Because the world is just too small. I think we have to understand that the technology today does not have borders. Knowledge does not have borders. Talent does not have borders. Our political systems, our mindset does have lots of borders. So it's okay. Maybe it will change over a period of time.
This question relates to what you were saying earlier about open source and the difference between nation building versus company building. So I've been following the open government platform for a long time, and it's completely opposite to some large companies like IBM and Cisco that are making completely closed source city, you know, smarter city, smarter planet. They make for really compelling posters at airports. And, you know, they're really, really expensive, you know, $1 million solutions for cities so that the city rulers can look over their citizens and be smart about it. So how do these two poles kind of meet?
They have to do their thing, we have to do our thing. Okay. I mean, they have to worry about, you know, revenues, and they know how to do that well than we do. Okay. And we have to do what we have to do. And wherever we can meet, we meet. If we can't meet, we don't meet. That's okay.
One more.
With us the whole day?
No.
Into the evening? No, okay.
I'm here only for a few days. I gotta go back Friday.
People can catch you in the next.
No, he's leaving in a few minutes.
Say it again?
Oh, leaving in a few minutes, okay.
Yeah, that's okay. I mean, I can spend a little more time, no problem.
Hello, thank you for your speech. It was very enlightening and inspirational. In regards to what you mentioned about the 1 billion in India and how you try to identify them, what are the concerns that you have in place for things that are happening in the US like identity theft? How are you going to handle that for 1 billion people? Are there any security measures in place?
Security is definitely a concern to all of us. We work with US government also on security. We understand security is a big issue, but it has to be solved. In the process, you'll have some problems too. Every technology has plus and minus. I always give example of knife. I can cut tomato and I can kill somebody. Take your pick. Okay. So you need to use knife.